I'm quoting from our author once again, okay? The claim is that if I conceive of the relation to the other in terms of understanding, correlation, symmetry, reciprocity, equality, and even, as has once again become fashionable, recognition, then that relation is totalized. Okay? When I totalize, I conceive of the relation to the other from some imagined point that would be outside of it, and I turn myself into a theoretical spectator on the social world of which I am really part, and in which I am an agent. Viewed from outside, intersubjectivity might appear to be a relation between equals, but from inside, that relation, as it takes place at this very moment, you place an obligation on me that makes you higher than me, more than my equal. Okay? It might be argued that much philosophy and social theory persistently totalizes relations with others. But for Levinas, there is no view from nowhere, and every view is from somewhere, and the ethical relation is a description from the point of view of an agent in the social world and not a spectator upon it. Okay? This is why Levinas emphasizes that subject is a living subject, not knowing subject, okay? It's a living subject, living in the world, experiencing things, and therefore sensuous subject. Prior to its being a knowing subject, the subject we are talking about is a sensuous subject, so to speak, okay? Reacting to the world or being in the world through it is senses and sensations, okay? So, that the ethical relationship, now therefore, since we put aside understanding and bring forward the question of the ethics, what the other assumes as it is form is nothing other than what Levinas would call as face. But what is a face? A face is the other. No, not at all. A face is the appearance of the other in a situation of ethical relationship. That's all, okay? This means that since that ethical relationship is not a relationship of knowing, there is no way for the same to know the other. If you know the other, if you recognize the other, if you establish an equal relationship with the other, all you are doing is dealing with that other inside the same and nothing else, okay? So however, our problem here is to tackle or deal with that real other, so to speak, sometimes called that radical other, okay? Not the other inside the same me, but that radical other. Since its alterity is radical, it means that it remains forever enigmatic from the point of view of the same. To put it another way, okay, we can also say that it can never be known by the same. The other can never be known, therefore remains forever enigmatic, okay? But the crucial point, therefore, is not to know the other, but assume that responsibility which is brought about by the simple appearance of the other in the horizon of being, okay? So the other shows itself there, or if you like, gives itself away, or if you like, there is before me in the being, okay? Il y a, a French term for German, es gibt. Levinas uses this very often, okay? It gives, you know, it can be translated in two ways. One way, the usual way, is to translate it as there is, but the other way, especially since the Heideggerian philosophy was in the scenery, it turned out to be to translate it much more appropriate in the form of it gives. Okay, so the other gives itself, showing itself away in the form of a face which remains forever enigmatic. So, in other words, politically, it means that if you try to know the other, What are you doing is to establish the superiority of the same, your own self, in other words, upon the other. Okay? So there is no question of knowing the other. If you try to establish an equal relationship with the other, again you are imposing the superiority of the same over the other. Okay? Simply because in each all of these cases, the terms of what we call democratic relationship, equality, understanding, you know, being compassionate towards the other, understanding feelings or needs or demands of the other, etc., have already been determined by the terms of the same. Okay? Now, language has been proposed here as the that neutral medium in Levinas's philosophical approach, as that neutral medium which turns out to be capable of establishing a performative relationship. By performative, we simply meaning acting and reacting in a face-to-face relationship towards each other, okay? That performative relationship in relation to the other. Through this, by clinging to this performative relationship in an act of responsibility, and this act of responsibility either is not a simple matter, simply because the other standing before us, exceeding our capacity to understand it, opening a horizon of infinity in the form of exteriority, forcing us towards an act of transcendence. Transcendence of what? Transcendence of the limitations of the self. Same. Okay? So, the same has its limits. You know, that's why I do not hesitate to draw that line here. Even though these limits may assume the form of a horizon in Husserlian and Heideggerian thinking, there are still limits. And the presence of the other actually showing itself at the very limit of that horizon. Okay? Here. At the very limit of that horizon and in the form of a face. Just an appearance. Okay? Just an appearance which does not represent the infinitude of the other. Okay? Why? Why we are talking about the infinitude of the other? It's simply for this reason. We are not capable of totalizing the other. You know, from the very beginning, you should be aware by now that totalization of something, erecting something as something, some specific a thing, so to speak, okay, requires that labor of totalization through the application of the concept. Okay. We know this from since Kant's time on, you know. Actually, practically speaking, so to speak, intuitions come to us in the form of a flux, of a manifold, remember, okay? And as such, they are not organized, they do not represent any unity at all, okay? It means that when I leave my conceptual structure, a priori structures of understanding, okay, the world would not show itself to me in any specific form at all. Okay? It means that if I am devoid of any concepts, for instance, for us sociologists, when I go to the people, you know, but going to the people involves a certain conceptualization of people, okay? Would turn out to be impossible. I wouldn't know where to go, with whom to talk, about what, etc. Okay? So, the fact, that's the point actually. The facts of our sociological analysis are not readily made over there, awaiting us to be studied. Okay? As Levinas puts it, it involves, requires a labor. For instance, in the case of the man of knowledge, that labor assumes the form of a mental, intellectual labor, the construction of concepts. Okay? So without concepts, there is no reality to study upon. Okay? And however, here we have a confrontation, an actual practical confrontation with a certain other. Levinas expresses this with the term in French. I don't know how to pronounce these terms. I don't know French, so autru, in contrast to autri, okay? Autri referring to any other, autru, or how to pronounce it, I really don't know, referring to that human other. Another human being, if you like, okay? So what's at stake is primarily that relationship with another human being. Now, at this point, one can rightfully ask that rather dizzying question to Levinas. Yeah, come on, man, what are you saying, okay? Are you saying to us that ethical relationship is limited to other human beings? What about the animals? What about the rest of the world? What about the planet we are right now destroying, for instance? Wouldn't we involve a kind of ethical relationship as you propose with the planet itself, with the animals themselves, etc., okay? So what are you saying? Actually, there is a limitation, but if one wishes, as you can see, the possibility is over there. It just takes establishing an equation between this other and that other, okay? When you have done this, there remains nothing specific to human beings, and the same, which is we are, okay, turns out to be responsible to the other, any other whatsoever, okay? It depends upon one's own preferences, of course. And another important, interesting point with this notion of responsibility is that this responsibility should or would necessarily be an infinite responsibility. Why? Because the other is infinite, okay? Because the other is infinite, and it's not in the hands of the same to determine what kind of possibilities the presence of the other at the horizon brings about, okay? Therefore, the presence of the other opening up an infinite range of possibilities which can be expected but may not be anticipated as well in the horizon of the same being, the same world, okay? So this means that the same cannot develop prejudgments with regard to how the other would act in a given situation of face-to-face relationship. Therefore, the same responsibility should necessarily be an infinite responsibility, which would be different from the modern conceptualization of responsibility, okay? Modern conceptualization of responsibility turns out to be a limited responsibility, which turns out to be binding only the activities of the self. However, here, in Levinasian conceptualization of infinite responsibility, what we have is that the same assumes that responsibility to the degree of being responsible for everything that takes place in that face-to-face situation. This means that the same is also or is responsible for assuming the responsibility of the other at the same time. And if you let me confess here at that point, this is the exact point where I see the danger, a serious danger of Levinasian thinking, okay? Simply because, as you can see, now, in modern situation which we hate, okay, what we have is the confrontation of two parties, two distinct parties, with their own limitations and, of course, with their own sins, okay? Nobody is deprived of sin, free from sin, and everybody is sinful. In other terms, everybody carrying, so to speak, the other in itself, okay? So when I see the other, when I recognize the otherness of the other, okay, remember, this turns out to be something disturbing for me. And of course, it's one of the usual reactions that each and every one of us, would try to bring forth certain modifications in the presence of the other. And let's ask, why not? Okay? Why should I leave the other as it is? Especially that other which I am forced to exist together with. Think about my friends. Why should I be establish friendships with everyone? Okay? I'm free to select my friends on my own. Okay? According to my own liking, of course. Okay? And I do not think that I am obliged to establish friendship relationships which with each and every other human being that I come across. Even these coming acrosses may contain face-to-face relationships. Actually, it is that exactly face-to-face relationships which encourage the establishment of friendship relations on the one hand, but at the same time bring about the possibility of hostile relations. Okay? Think about that other which I do not live together and do not find myself in face-to-face relations. Okay, why should I care much about that other that does not come into my face-to-face situation? Okay? And exactly in the face-to-face situation, I began to consider the other, take the other as my object of knowledge, and try to make modifications in that other. Think about our own relationships with the other persons. Those persons who are closest to us are turned out to be the subject of our most effective efforts of modification. When I live with somebody, for instance, it's on that somebody I want to make modifications. If that somebody lives somewhere else, on another street, I do not care what somebody does or does not. Okay? When we are together in face-to-face relationships, these efforts of modification comes into the picture and actually constitutes the very core of the social relationship. Okay? When I say that we both engage, I'm not saying, however, that this is an innocent act, okay? This is an act of power, exercise of power, okay? When you say to your friend that you don't like to be light, okay? That you actually ban, bring a ban, okay? Bring a prohibition to the life of your friend, okay? You prohibit your friend. You strip your friend from its power, right, whatever you call it, of lying to you. Okay? You make an enforcement onto the friend. And not necessarily all the bunch of these enforcements can be taken as acts of friendship always, you know? Such situations can easily come between the couples living together, for instance. Yeah, I love him, she loves me, but what she says to me turns out to be quite disturbing for me. And what I enforce her to do, okay, turns out to be an exercise of power. Yeah, say, that patriarchal loving husband, okay, I am exercising violence on my wife and she likes it. Okay, and suddenly the wife goes to the court raising complaints. Why? Everything was going fine, okay? Suddenly, why you are doing this? You were happy, I was happy, okay? But the situation, it appears that what I think was a happy situation in such situations turned out to be not accepted or taken by my wife as the examples of occasions of happy situations. This means that I am reading the situation with my own codes, my wife reading the situation with her own codes. Okay? Is there a point of reconciliation? Yeah, we are going to talk about it. There is a point of reconciliation which, however, unfortunately does not pass from my assuming that infinite responsibility. And worse still, it's very dangerous if I really assume infinite responsibility. What I do is worse than my reduction of the other into being an object of my consciousness. Actually, I am almost totally annihilating that other as the other, simply because everything happens in this situation falls into my responsibility. Even what you say in the form of an objection, in the form of a counter struggle, whatever they are, okay, turns out to be the expression of the acts of my infinite responsibility. This means that you don't have any saying at all in this situation. The other cannot have any saying at all. Now, come back to this. What established, according to this schema, the possible relationship of exteriority with the other in the form of the same assuming infinite responsibility is language. But the question is that, is really the language that neutral medium the two of the parties can exist together on an equal or whatever, on an ethical footing, on an ethical relationship, okay? The problem is that, don't forget where the other made its appearance. The other, in the form of the face, made its appearance in the horizon of my same. The field between me and him or her is my field. What's at stake is the horizon of my field, okay? If I'm standing within here, if I'm standing here, okay, this field that we cover as the social relationship, which is assumed to be connected with each other through language, through the medium of language, through the medium of performative speech actually, is this field. Not that field. Actually, Levinas appears to speak about this field and forcing the same to open itself, this infinitude of the other, this infinitude of this field, okay? But the unfortunate situation is that for the other to make its appearance, okay, it has to show itself in the horizon of this same. Otherwise, one can easily say that we cannot talk about any possibility of face-to-face situation. Okay, simply because I wouldn't see that the other, I wouldn't hear that the other, if that other does not show itself in the horizon of my awareness. In other words, simply put, I should be aware of the fact that somebody is sitting over there, okay? But this distance is the distance covered within the field of my awareness and nowhere else, okay? Since it is the fact, it means that the medium that we establish between the same and the other to be able to connect them, whether it assumes the form of language or any other thing, for instance, in Husserl, intuitions, etc., or in Heidegger, concernful dealings, etc. Don't forget, in each and every case, intuitions belong to subject, concernful dealings belong to that particular Dasein, and here again, we have the same. The other must necessarily show itself in the horizon of the same, okay? So that field is within the same, and which means that it is determined by the rules and regulations, or if you like, a priori structures of the same. And language is exactly that a priori structure, okay? Language is exactly that a priori structure of the same, establishing the field, enabling a certain coming to face to face with the other. The other is making a call. Yeah, the same is responding to that call, and this all happening within the space created by the language of the same. Or, let's try to think more positively. Is it possible that language turned out to be something intersubjective, so to speak? You know, from Saussure on, we know that language is something social. This has many implications. If I take, for instance, social as a unity, say Turkish language, okay, This Turkish language turns out to be the medium through which the components of Turkishness communicate with each other, get into relations with each other, okay? Therefore, establishing a field of totality, which means that those who cannot speak Turkish language cannot enter into it. For them to be able to enter into that field, think about the Kurds. How are they gonna come into this field? How are they gonna make their appearance in the field created or distributed by the Turkish language? When they speak Turkish, we do not understand them. Kurdish, sorry, we do not understand them. They are just making rumbling sounds, that's all, okay? They have to adapt to be able to heard by the same. They have to adapt themselves. That's why the minorities find themselves forced to learn the language of the majority. Always. Never a case that majority learns the language of the minority, however. That's the problem. For instance, for the overwhelming majority of the Kurds now living in Turkey, you can easily say that if they have not forgotten Kurdish, okay, they are bilingual. What about the Turks here in this country? Are they bilingual? Is there any one of them among only very rare exceptions, apart from very rare exceptions, is there any one single or group who can speak Kurdish here in this country? No. Okay. So, for a Kurd to make herself heard by a Turk, that Kurd is necessarily comes to learn that language of the Turk. Okay. So the field is already being determined. This is the meaning of making appearance in the horizon. Or it may assume the form of noise. Acts of terror, for instance. Okay? Form of noise which nobody can understand, only feel the existence of some disturbance. Okay? The existence of some problem whose causes or whose real meaning nobody can decipher. Okay? No, it is ununderstandable why certain human beings coming, falling onto whole villages and killing, including men, children, women, etc. Okay? It's ununderstandable. Why somebody comes along and explodes a bomb in the center of the city? I don't understand this. They themselves die and causing the death of many innocent and unrelated people. This is noise. Okay? And we cannot understand its meaning. We cannot decipher its meaning. Why? Simply because it remains outside of the field of language. Okay? That's why we call each other to talks. But the problem is that talks can only be achieved within the confines of one language. In other words, parties engaging in talks should be able to understand each other. Okay? And this understanding, for instance, I'm not only referring here to Turkish or Kurdish language. I'm referring to that language that sets or gives priority to human life. But for us, the human life, for us who adapt themselves into modernity, the human life may be the most important concept of our language. But what about those who risk their lives in each and every day, independent of whether they will it or not? Can we really consider that human life turns out to be the most important value in their language? No. Okay? So, say, for instance, law. A couple of weeks ago, we were in a sociology conference here. And I heard with very pleasure the work of our friends on Soma workers. Okay? And a couple of days later, we have invited and forced, so to speak, to participate a seminar. What was the name of the seminar? We were there together. iş güvenliği, job security or something like that, okay? That man was talking about law, existence of a law which had been accepted, enacted in Turkey, say, 2 decades ago, declaring that if the workers find that workplace is not secure enough, they can reject working. Come and tell this to those who are forced to go down into the mines in Soma. Okay? Now, we were talking about law, the superiority of law. That law can be important for me. But let's raise the question, how much importance that law can have in the lives and conceptions of those people? Now. Okay? So how are we going to communicate? We are not talking the same language. Or somebody, then the disadvantaged is usually, should necessarily be forced to learn the language of the advantaged. Okay? Yeah, if you want to tell something, tell it in my own terms. If you want to speak to me, speak in the voice of humanity. Speak in the voice of the law. Okay? If you are breaching in your speech the law, I cannot hear you. I can understand you. If you are not valuing human life in your speech, I don't hear you. So, the very appearance of the face in the horizon cannot be taken as if accidental and as if some neutral event. The very appearance, the form of the face, if you like, had already been conditioned by the field which the face shows its appearance in the horizon. Okay? So that's the problem. And if that is the case, this means that speech acts, ordinary, usual speech acts, okay, cannot establish that ethical relation. Actually, what's at stake? Truly, within the communication through language, what's at stake is exactly the power relationship. Who is powerful is setting up the rule, actually an analysis of which we are going to see when we discuss a very beautiful article written by Derrida, Force of Law, which had been inspired by Levinasian thinking once again. But the problems turn out to be much more visible there. Okay, with respect to the question of, you know, this field in our social existence had been established by the law. The language we are speaking here is nothing else than the law, actually. Okay, how an act can be interpreted as a performative, for instance. Okay, an act in itself is never something. Only and only an act turns to be an act when it is capable of creating an effect on something. That was why I was bringing the question repeatedly of acting and being acted upon. Poyeyin kaypaskeyin. Without one, the other is impossible. Okay? And this possibility refers to the existence of the law. Remember, last time when we were discussing the possibility of the new showing itself. Without the pre-given existence of a tradition, if you like establishment, or if you like law, the new cannot show itself. Okay? So, for the new to be there, to appear, there got to be a law over here. Okay? So that's the problem, and that problem poses itself in Levinas' thinking by an article written by Jacques Derrida in 1966 entitled Violence and Metaphysics. Okay? Actually, Levinas here trying to formulate a metaphysics which would be counter against violence, towards violence, okay? Actually, what he was trying to do is, I'm sure, with full of good intentions. Okay. And he was simply saying, let's do not kill each other. Let's assume a more responsible attitude in relation to each other. But it appears that philosophically at least, or within the structure of a coherent theory, this turns out to be difficult. Why? One simple reason, apart from other difficulties, is that thinking or developing such an attitude requires the usage of language. And that usage of language is not an innocent something, okay? It is language that establishes totalities themselves, okay? So Levinas, in his later work, in his 1970 work, Otherwise Than Being, had been forced under the light of the critique developed out by Derrida, and he says himself that he has been haunted by this critique throughout this time. Derrida has been forced to establish a distinction between what he calls the saying and the said. Okay? The said actually simply can be understood the structures of established language, while the saying trying to refer to those performative acts taking place actually through and through in a face-to-face situation. But the problem is that we are writing articles, essays, books. And when we are writing articles, essays, books, what we are written, okay, simply turns out to be the said rather than say. Huh? Okay? Levinas then tries to give his writing from then on, would try to give his writing a certain sensibility that would allow his writing to act as if a performative say. But the unfortunate situation again is this, that it is not possible to separate the said and the saying from each other in a rather so radical fashion. Okay? Actually, what is more dangerous, if you all ask me, is exactly what Levinas describes as the saying rather than the said. Simply because what we practically do to the other actually takes place in that face-to-face relations. Okay? The other said is not told to the other, is not said to the other. That said in the form of articles, books, are actually said to the friends, not to the other. Said to the components of the same, actually. Okay? Simply because the book I've written are not going to be read by my enemies. I'm writing it to my friends. Okay? But I am acting towards each and everyone in face-to-face situations, either friendly or hostile. But yet, Levinasian thinking, even though I see such impossibilities and serious dangers, and the danger, I think, is this, okay? The total annihilation of the other in the capacity of the same to assume that infinite responsibility. As we will see when we analyze Derrida's article, that capacity to assume infinite responsibility in a face-to-face situation is not something, actually would not something that turn out to be desirable, but rather worse than that apprehending the other, okay? Okay, this brings me to the end of the discussion. Do you have any questions or whatever? Just one more sentence perhaps to it. Even though I loaded my presentation with my own critics with respect to Levinasian thinking, the certain reason is that it is one of the most current, actually not one of the, I guess it is the most popular theoretical perspective prevailing today in our contemporary world, in our dealings with the world. Even Trump, Donald Trump, assuming certain sentences from Levinas' position, okay, but unfortunately not bringing us any possibility of peace. So there lies the real danger, actually. Okay, that's why I rather freely shared my critiques with regard to Levinasian thinking, simply because it is the most effective one today. The days of postmodernity are over, in other words. We are in another world. Okay?